programming at the Museum of Contemporary Art, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you all here to the final night of the 18th season of Mixed Taste.
Yeah, give it up for that.
Yeah, it's so, to see all of your beautiful faces, we're so happy to have you here.
Absolutely. By round of applause, though, how many of you have been to the Holiday Theater before? It's good, it's growing.
Yeah, it's getting better.
How many of you have been to a Mixed Taste event before? Even more.
A lot of hands.
Well, if this is your first, your 50th time, we're really, really glad you're here with us. The Holiday Theater is MCA's home for music, performances, and fun.
Yes. Well, if you've been to this before, you're probably sick of this by now, but we have an option where you can play along tonight on your phone. You can ask questions, you can play games, and we practice that by having you scan this QR code right here, and you can answer our icebreaker question. And the icebreaker question that we ask you tonight is, if you could completely reshape the world with your imagination, what's one bold and radical change that you would make to create a better world for all? Yeah, no big deal, just a little minor question.
Yeah, yeah. What? And for whatever reason, if the QR code isn't working, you can go to slido.com and enter the word mixed taste, all one word, to access this. But let's take a look here. Folks are saying world peace.
I mean, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good one, Ken. Align AI.
Okay. Ensure all children are clothed, safe, and fed.
Overturn capitalism.
Yeah. Yeah. Reparations. All right. We agree. No more tomatoes. Oh, come on.
Yeah.
That would mean no ketchup, no enchilada sauce.
Yeah.
No, there's a lot of things that would go away.
Eat the rich.
Healthcare. Yes.
Agree. Dill pickle cereal. See, this is why we can't have nice things. This is orgasm on contact.
I mean, I think that would be awkward.
That would be a lot.
No straight white male bosses.
Kindness.
Okay, a housing for all.
I think we should just do this the whole show.
Yeah, I think this is great.
Yeah.
I mean, I think their imaginations are already
it's going,
pretty
yeah.
radical.
Crush the patriarchy. We are in the Barbie era.
It's not just horses anymore, guys.
Everyone's gay in this new future state.
Yeah. Recognition for our cat overlords.
Men are victims. Okay. I don't know if we need any victims in our radically imagined future, but let's...
This is the utopia we're imagining.
Anyway, I think you get the idea.
Yeah,
we
okay,
could do this
on
and on and on. It's great. So it's working. Be sure to leave your name when you're leaving questions, because we will give a prize later for the person who makes the best connection in our Q&A later, as chosen by our digital producer, Dele. Let's go. Let's do this, huh?
All right. Mixed Taste is a mashup series where we bring together two experts who each present on different topics, and then we take question and answer on both topics together. Oh, come on. This is the sixth and final night. We can do that better. We take question and answer together on both topics.
At the same time. So the rules are very simple. We have one speaker go up for 20 minutes and give a speech on their topic. The second speaker will come up and give a 20-minute talk on a completely unrelated topic. And then we will do a Q&A. During the first section of the program, no connections between topics are allowed, but during the Q&A, anything can happen.
All right, between the talks tonight, we are going to play a quick game. And at the end of the evening, a formerly local poet, but now a international poet, and you may recognize him if you came to Mixed Taste before. Brenton Zola is back in the house tonight. I agree. Let's give it up for Brenton, and he is going to perform an original poem or maybe something else that is inspired by the talks tonight. All right, so let's start by introducing our first speaker, who's going to be presenting tonight on a light, easy subject, the penal system.
Yeah.
I think it'll be fun. Viniyanka Prasad is an advocate for cultural equality and criminal justice, including through her service as the founder and executive director of The Word, a storytelling sanctuary. It's a literary arts nonprofit engaging storytelling for equity. She also serves as the co-chapter head for PIN, America's Denver chapter, and on the Denver Commission for Cultural Affairs. And, as if that wasn't enough, she's also a practicing public criminal defense attorney. So please give a warm welcome for Viniyanka Prasad.
There we go. Hi. I know y'all are excited for this really lighthearted topic that was just previewed for you. Thanks for being here with me to get through this. But I think there's some things that we can really think about here. I think we'll start with talking about my two worlds that I come from. You know, a lot of people think that they're very different worlds. Like, I made a big left turn when I started a literary arts nonprofit after being a public defender for many years. But the truth is, to me, they're both systems change. And so that's kind of what I'm here to share a little bit about, is that idea of what system change really is. And so I'm going to start exactly where you would think I would start, with Ayurvedic medicine. So when I was thinking about talking about how these two things come together, it really struck me the idea in Ayurvedic medicine of three elements rather than the four that we generally think of here in the West. So in Ayurveda, there is air, there is fire, and then land and water are actually one element combined. And it really is this idea to me of movement is foundation, and foundation is also movement. And really thinking about how do those things manifest in our world around us. So let's start with the idea of foundation and get on the same page about the foundation of what the penal system looks like. I'm really gonna hope that at this point, there's some things that we all do already know, and that some of this is not going to be new to you. But the US is the world leader in incarceration, so go us, we're number one. And among that, I think it's really important to point out that Native Americans are 38% more likely to be incarcerated than white Americans. In Colorado, Latin Americans are 2.2 times more likely to be incarcerated. And Black Americans are 4.8 times more likely to be incarcerated. Yeah, those are the right numbers, I promise. In 1983 in Colorado, there were 6,000 people incarcerated. In 2020, 30,000 people. And at any time, a third to a half of those have not been convicted of anything that they have been arrested for. So, that's a rock solid place to start, I think. Given that reality, I'm sure that the foundational story that we all have in our head about what our justice system looks like is that we have these really solid trial rights, right? We wouldn't allow this system to be the one that we're utilizing that affects so many people every single day without all of the things that we know to be so important. You're entitled to an attorney, you're presumed innocent, right? There are all these procedures built into the trial that make sure that we can really trust what happens. And we know that the people who we are incarcerating are the people who we want to be incarcerating. So let's kind of look at some of that, right? One of those trial rights that you probably know about is that on the defense side, you get to present witnesses. You have a right to present witnesses on your own behalf, present a defense. So let's think about how that happens. So there has to be really an investigation before a defendant can present a defense on their own behalf, right? So what does investigation look like? Well, so I worked in the federal defender's office out in the Chicagoland area, so I do want to preface that this is my experience out there in federal court. But this is who the US attorneys, the prosecutors, had investigating for them. You know, just the FBI, ATF, that's alcohol, tobacco, and firearms, the DEA, the Secret Service, the US Marshals, the IRS. On. And you know, if it wasn't enough, they also go to local law enforcement. Not only do they work with local law enforcement, but they have to deputize local law enforcement just to say, hey, really, there are more feds out there. So that's who the prosecutors were working with. Now, I had the privilege of working with an incredible investigator, Apollon Bodwin, good friend of mine, incredible, could get any person in the world to talk to him. I'm so privileged to have worked with him. So at the federal defenders, we had Apollon. So parity, right? That, yep, same, same. I think that can show us exactly how we end up in a place where the defense is exactly on the same scale as the prosecution, and definitely we trust that outcome at the end of the day, right? But so if that's what we're working with in terms of building the evidence, then it surely must be that when we get to the point of having presented evidence to a jury, we're very careful about how, what instructions we give them, how we're really setting them up to understand the evidence that's being in front of them, right? So here's a little rule that we work with. This is a foundational truth of the Seventh Circuit, is that we presume that juries follow the instructions that are given by the court. So whatever the court has said, this is the law, you have to follow it. We presume that after we've told the jury that, that they do, in fact, follow. Here is what's called the pattern jury instructions. So there are 10,085 pages of pattern instructions out of the Seventh Circuit, right? That's a lot of instructions that basically a judge can look to and say, we've all kind of agreed that this is how we should instruct a jury, right? We're being careful. We want to make sure that we've given them the right instructions. So I think we all in this room understand that there are things that a jury is, which is human beings, right? And imperfect human beings. We know these little things called unconscious bias. We have questions about cross-cultural assumptions. A lot of times, juries and the person who's in the defendant's stand or maybe not, maybe have not had the same life experiences. I think we can all, you know, agree that that's probably true, right? So surely, in 10,000 pages of jury instructions, we make sure that we really prep a jury for that reality, right? So I haven't practiced in the Seventh Circuit for a minute, so I actually went back in preparing for this and kind of perused these many, many jury instructions just to, you know, make sure that nothing has changed. I was pretty certain that nothing had changed, but I wanted to make sure. And here's the one place that I found any suggestion of unconscious bias. Solved it. Yeah? Yeah, I'm pretty sure. We can trust that that's exactly what is happening. But let's talk about, if we dig down deep into like specific evidence, maybe there's something more tangible that we're telling juries to really help them get to that place of addressing their unconscious bias. One piece of evidence that I think we're all pretty familiar with that goes in front of a jury is eyewitness testimony, right? We're all pretty sure that that's strong evidence that should be presented to a jury. There's no question that if someone said, I saw exactly who committed this robbery, that should go in front of a jury, right? Well, turns out, actually we're pretty sure that should not go in front of a jury, or at least not without a lot of caveats, right? Because there's pretty much irrefutable science that says that memory is actually pretty malleable. We change what we recall as we're recalling it. We can rewrite our own sense of what happened based on our current feelings, based on our current impressions, based on how that memory was formed in the first place, especially when a memory is formed under trauma. What actually gets contained in your brain may be very, very different from what was happening, in fact, at that moment. And now let's think about what's really, really important in the criminal justice system is that there's so many instances in which an eyewitness is identifying someone across races. So cross-racial identifications are the best. They are responsible for 66, so the Innocence Project did a study of its own cases. The Innocence Project is a group that takes cases back to court when there's new DNA evidence that wasn't there at the time of the original trial, and it leads to a lot of convictions being overturned when that new evidence shows that the individual who was convicted could not have been responsible. So in a survey of their own cases, in 216 cases that were overturned, 66 of them included cross-racial identifications. In a Miami study, pretty similar numbers, 42% of convictions in Miami that were found to be false involved cross-racial identifications. So, again, in all of those jury instructions, I went back and made sure, because it has been a minute, so I did go back, and here's what I found. So, take into account the witness's memory. Very specific. We very specifically addressed that problem. I feel really good at the end of the day, don't you? Okay. So, I don't have a ton of time in 20 minutes to go through all of the different things that make up the foundation of the jury system, but hopefully that's given you a little bit of a flavor to rethink some of what you thought a jury trial looks like. So now let's talk about the bigger picture of, you know, what do we do? The world is full of bad things. Things are happening, and we have to keep each other safe. That's what we're doing, and we're doing our best. We're trying to do our best, right? We need to keep each other safe. So I just want to point to a super necessary law coming back home a little closer to you all, not out of Chicagoland, here in Colorado. So basically this says if you have been prescribed medication and you put it in a different bottle, that's illegal. Illegal. I feel so much safer now knowing that this law is on the books. Don't you? Don't you feel so much safer? I mean, I have to tell you, every single time that I do that, when I go to the airport and I dump all my pills into one bag, I'm so glad to know that this law is protecting me from all the other people who are doing that. Now, I should be fair. It does say, unless you're able to show that you're the legal owner of that controlled substance. So, cool, cool. That whole innocent until proven guilty thing, we don't need that in this case. Nope, nope. All right, so a couple of things that I've given you to think about foundationally. I want to go to the real, real foundation, which is why do we punish? I think we have a story in our heads about what punishment is meant to do. The idea of keeping each other safe, the idea of accountability, the idea of reform and growth, and all of those things that we have been told is the heart of the reason that we have this beautiful system in which we really make sure that we are targeting only those people who we are meaning to target. So let's think about that a little bit. This is the system that we're using because it's the one we've always had, right? Well, in 1852, California had one prison, San Quentin. Between 1852 and the 1970s, California had 9 prisons. So a century, California had 9 prisons for an entire century. It was in the 1980s, between the 1980s and today, the number of prisons in California increased by 74%. So we've always been doing this, right? You know, since 1980. The capacity of California's current prison system is 85,000 people, and it is considered dismally overcrowded. So, clearly, the one prison from 1852, it showed us how we have to do things, right? Now, here's something else that may be new to you. I think you probably all have heard of laws like vagrancy or disorderly conduct, public intoxication. Those all seem pretty standard today, right? And at some point, you know, we must have all decided that those are important things for us to regulate. Maybe it's so that we can get to crime before crime starts. Whatever the reason may be, we had decided collectively that those are important things to regulate. Well, actually, those crimes really didn't exist until shortly after the Civil War. And it was shortly after the Civil War that Southern states, who now had large free black populations, created something called the Black Codes. And these were essentially criminal codes that were made only for freed black individuals. And it was in the Black Codes that the idea of vagrancy and disorderly conduct were first introduced into our criminal system. And they are now very much a part of almost every criminal code at a state or local level. So I just wonder, this tool that we have decided is the one that we use because we have always been using it, how did we decide that this was the tool that we needed? When did we collectively come to that agreement? And so that actually brings me back to our dear movement and foundation. Is the foundation that we have, the story of the foundation that we have, is that the actual story? Or is part of movement pausing to ask that question about what the foundation really is? Pausing to have space in which we really see one another, hear one another's truths through storytelling, literary arts, see? Can we work on this foundational piece of understanding, question what is happening right now, and from there, find a place where we can move forward? Is that systems change? Is systems change only a question of going into court and asking for better jury instructions and looking for policy change that gives more resources to the federal defender's office? Or is it that the ground beneath our feet is shifting always, and we have to look at it and really figure out how we want to move with it? All right, thanks. I hope I didn't depress you too much.
Thank you so much, Viniyanka. And now it's halftime.
It's halftime.
It's been really, really cool this year. We have had Chanel from Black People Know Things curating our halftime entertainment. And tonight, she has a quiz for us on the penal system and radical imagination. And so please welcome Chanel. Give her a round of applause there. And joining Chanel in this fun competition is Brenton Zola, our poet for this evening. Welcome Brenton to the stage. Take it away, Chanel.
Okay. Hello. My name is Chanel. I am the host of Black People Know Things Trivia. I'm so excited to be here with y'all tonight. They gave me this Beyonce mic. I feel like Beyonce. Woo! Okay. They told me not to dance. So before we start our quiz, Brenton can dance, I can't. Brenton and I are just gonna play some games with y'all.
Yeah.
How y'all feel about that? Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Okay, the first thing that Brenton and I would like y'all to do is turn to someone you don't know.
That's right, turn to a stranger.
A stranger.
That's right.
Right? I like
find
how people-
a stranger.
I like how y'all started doing it before you know what's gonna happen next.
Yep.
That's bold of y'all.
Okay, so with that stranger, all you're going to do is you're going to tell that stranger something that is true about you that you wouldn't normally share with a stranger.
Yeah. You got 30 seconds.
Timer.
is. Time's up. Time is up. Look. Look at all this fun, y'all.
They're in their own world. All right, wrap up your true shares. All right, wrap it up. How was that? Viniyanka just taught us that it's very easy to make preconceptions about the people who are around us. And sometimes it's a powerful thing to actually learn something about someone that might pass those preconceptions. And so hopefully you learned something that maybe surprised you, interested you, caused intrigue, or formed a point of connection.
Oh, did somebody say use my voice? No, I will not. I know my kid went back to school today, y'all. It's okay. Anybody? I know I wanted to ask y'all to betray whoever you just talked to and tell us the secret they told y'all. Just who cares about friendship? You know, that's like a jury. No, okay. Okay, our next activity is a call and response. Let's do a call and response. How y'all know what a call and response is? Okay, I got some claps. Not enough claps for as many people are in here, but I'll explain. So I'm gonna say something really cool, okay? And then I need y'all to shout something back to me really cool. But I'm gonna tell y'all what to say. Don't get creative, okay? I'm gonna help y'all out. Okay, the first thing I'ma say is ain't no party like a Denver party. And I want y'all to shout back, you know, like that. Just like that, do the head, just like that. I don't care if you ain't got no rhythm, tonight's your night. Okay, all right. Ain't no party like a Denver party.
You know.
Oh, every way, which way? I like that, it was like the C, you know? Y'all couldn't see it, all right. You got one for him?
I have one for you. I'm an African, so this is I'll do an African call and response. This is normally a sort of gathering of community, and the phrase goes tuwimbe, mase kule. And so I'm gonna say tuwimbe, you're gonna say mase kule. Okay? So let's practice. Mase kule.
Mase kule.
Tuwimbe.
Mase kule.
Tuwimbe.
Mase kule.
Tuwimbe. Tuwimbe. It means together we gather and together we sing. Tuwimbe. Tuwimbe. Let's go.
Yeah, that was great. Y'all put on for the hood. That was great. All around. What area is this? Low high. Yeah, they heard y'all. Right? All right, y'all ready for our quiz tonight? Yes, yes, yes. Y'all got y'all Slidos up? Okay, I'll give you a second. Don't worry. I know y'all was having fun. Y'all was dancing. Tonight, y'all are going to be going against Britton in trivia. Are y'all ready for that? I know Britton was like, ooh, like me. I'm cool, but he's your enemy. Okay? So stay focused.
You don't have to like me. It's okay.
No, like them later, but right now. All right.
This is a one out of 10 of difficulty.
I'm going to read the questions, and then we're going to have Britton answer, and then we'll see what the audience has to say. Sounds good? All right. What are the inventors and engineers at Disney called? Mouseketeers, Imagineers, Mickey's Crew, or Radicalists?
Definitely Radical Scientists.
Definitely. Radical science. That's your final answer?
No, it's not a final answer. They're called Imagineers.
Imagineers. What do y'all, yeah. Let's see what the audience said. Okay. All right. Tied up. Okay, we gave y'all a little, I don't know if y'all been reading this summer. I just tried to wake y'all up a little bit. Ready for the next one?
Yep.
Okay. Who wrote the new Jim Crow
mass incarceration in the age of colorblindness. Ta-Nehisi Coates,
Michelle Alexander, Umar Johnson, or Colson Whitehead? What you think?
Well, Colson Whitehead is a fiction author, so it's definitely not him. Who actually just dropped a really good new book. I'm going to go with Ta-Nehisi Coates.
Okay. All right, Ta-Nehisi Coates. What's the audience? Let's see what the audience thinks.
Oh, maybe not.
Uh-oh.
Oh, it's Michelle Alexander. No.
It was Michelle Alexander.
I was thinking of Between the World and Me.
Yeah.
No, I was thinking of the wrong book. That's my bad.
Two for the audience, one for Brenton. Let's see. What does radical imagination mean? Believing that you can do anything, inventing anything you can think of, believing that the future can be completely unlike the world today, or believing that the future is now.
I mean, it's kind of like a trick question. I feel like the last two can both work.
Which one are you thinking? Oh, Beyonce version? Oh my gosh, she's such a great performer.
I'm gonna go with, I don't know, I think three and four are both good, but I'm gonna go with three.
Three. Okay. All right. What is the audience feeling? Let's see. Okay. Y'all agreed. Y'all are both correct. Yes. Yes. All right.
I think that's three for
the audience, two for you. Sounding good? True or false, Afrofuturism is an example of radical imagination. Who keeps saying that? Who's goofy voice? It's such a good come on. I want it on my phone. Come on. Come on.
I mean, so...
I got distracted. I'm back. True or false?
I would say that's true, but I would add an addendum that the Afrofuturism that we think of, which is very limited by things like Black Panther, I think the scope of it is much wider when we read things like Octavia Butler, when we read the writings of Audre Lorde, bell hooks. Like, there's a lot about radical imagination that goes far beyond just like technology and superhero movies.
Mm. True. The answer is true, plus what Brenton said. Yep. Hell yeah. Ava DuVernay directed this documentary about the disproportionately high number of Black people in prison. Was it Oz, Time, 13th, or Conviction? Yeah, this was on Netflix. So if you ain't seen it, tonight's your night. Uh-oh.
I have not heard of this documentary. I'm really
Uh-oh,
not sure.
Tonight's your night. It's a good one.
All titles that could be the titles of a documentary.
These are.
I don't think it's called Fiction. That doesn't sound like a documentary title to me. Disproportionately high number of people in prison. Oz. That doesn't sound right. 13th? Does it have to do with the 13th Amendment, maybe? I'll go with 13.
Everybody said, yeah. They just wanted you to get it so bad.
Yeah.
They said, yes. That's how I am. If I'm doing quizzes with friends, I'm just telling everybody the answers. Let's all have fun. Okay, yes, it was called 13th, and yeah, you gotta watch it now.
What's that?
Oh, despite only making up 13% of the U.S. population, what percentage of the prison population is Black?
Ooh.
67%, 48%, 25%, or 38%?
Hmm. That's a hard one.
I know. I feel like in the speech, this was a different answer. So just go with your heart.
I am gonna go with 38.
Yeah, that's what I have on here. But I like that y'all said 48. That's good. Just half of us. That means one of us on stage is in prison. We out. Look at my ankle. Okay. I'm a stand-up comedian. That's my real job, just so y'all know. I like dark humor. But it was 38%. That's what you tied up with the audience?
No.
Are you playing? Are you serious? They gave you an answer, so I don't know.
That's true.
Yeah. What do y'all think, audience? What, tied up or y'all won? I heard a we won from the, come on! I heard that from the, thank y'all so much for playing with us tonight. Have a great rest of the show.
That a great.
And now, on with the show.
But their work has, been inspiring for over a decade to me. And I think that we have waves of creativity. I know this as a creative person. I'm in and out of ideas and creativity and moving forward. But my friend here, Molina Speaks, is an artist. He's a live scribe poet, master of ceremonies. His mission is to unite the human spirit through radical imagination. Molina is the son of a Mexican immigrant father and a Chicana mother from Wyoming. Molina's artistic legacy includes serving as creative director of Youth on Record, being named a Westward Mastermind, and building permanent installation at Meowulf that commemorates the life and art of the late Chicano painter Esteban Lucero. Molina is an honoree of the Lalo Delgado Poetry Festival, and a room has been named for Molina at the Denver Foundation's Casa Grande on Poets Row. Give it up for Molina Speaks.
All right, let's start with a breath together. Take it in. Thank you. I will open with an invocation to the radical imagination, because one must claim his, her, or their power in order to impact the chaotic and multidimensional reality that we all share. I'm gonna ask you to take a leap with me to trust in the collective by speaking this opening declaration with me. It is simply called, We Declare. Just repeat after me. We declare.
We declare.
We declare.
We declare.
We declare our place here.
We declare our place here.
Above all as spiritual entities.
With the right to exist.
Without question. We declare all declarations. And all rights to declare all declarations. As we see fit, now and always, for the betterment and fulfillment of all promises of humanity, past, present, and future. We declare. Give yourselves a round of applause. I'm Adrian H. Molina, also known as Molina Speaks. My mission is to unite the human spirit through the radical imagination. Creativity is the information superhighway to the soul. I acknowledge that I am oftentimes engaged in a failing mission to unite the human spirit. It is quite easy with all of our information, social media, and constant access to information to assess the range of human conflicts that fuel the nuclear crisis, the climate crisis, the 32 current wars between countries and territories, and the many internal conflicts within nations and communities. We are divided by race, class, gender, religion, age, and geography. Oftentimes, we find that charismatic figures and institutions that condemn racism, discrimination, oppression, and division are often engaged in the practice of isms themselves, just from a different angle. It seems that even when we are well aligned within small groups of intentional people fighting for a common cause, we find ourselves entangled in meaningless and unnecessary conflicts. I recently took a sober analysis of my own life, strained relations between family members and friends, the many failed dreams of community within the various stages of my life, the many conflicts within scenes and social movements that I have at times called home, the multiple visions of home that would not come to fruition, no matter how hard I tried, the times that radical honesty blew up in my face, those who have failed me, those whom I have failed, the radically imaginative ways that I have unsuccessfully tried to organize myself, my friends, my fellow artists and coworkers to be something different than what we are offered. Looking deeper into your own life, I am sure that everyone here can relate. If you cataloged all of the dreams of your life that have either been broken, dispossessed, or deferred. As I theorized this presentation this summer, I began to question my mission, to unite the human spirit through the radical imagination. For historical context, there are four pillars to my creativity. My work has been shaped by hip-hop, Chicano art, my two children, and the natural world. I started songwriting at the age of 15, and from there came many flashes of inspiration, poetry, purpose, experimentation, and short-term goals. I did not, however, have a centralized mission. This mission to unite the human spirit through the radical imagination, that came after the birth of my daughter, Solanita, in 2015. The radical presence with her, deep listening, play, a homeschooling mission, she taught me more about the radical imagination than what I could teach her about it. She's now 8 years old. As she and our relationship grew, my mission came into clear focus. This summer, as I weighed the disappointments and the weights of the world, I began to think that perhaps my mission was too lofty, too unrealistic. Maybe it was time to abandon this mission altogether and find a new mission. Or perhaps I could tweak it some. Perhaps the mission was not to unite the human spirit through the radical imagination. Perhaps the mission was to simply spark the radical imagination, period. After all, this sparking of inspiration is what it seems that I have been up to since I first picked up a pen. And this carried forward into my declaration of self as a professional artist in 2008. Professional, meaning that I plan to make money and raise children on the strength of my creative path. I'm an idea machine. I'm always trying to do something new. I've written many volumes of poetry and albums that span countless genres, concepts, and themes. I've curated many events, small and large scale. I like to get in and shake some shit up, stir up the pot, and sometimes I'm not trying to stick around for the outcomes, you know? Once the work of art is completed, I'm ready to move on to the next project. It helps me to keep things moving and not get stuck in self-doubt. Plus, sparking a fuse or a feeling, igniting people's fire to create, it's a much easier task than trying to unify humanity. It's hard enough, after all, to unify even a small group of close friends to plan a fun day out of town or an evening out in the world. Since I've been reflecting on changing my mission, I didn't tell anybody about these reflections. I tend to meditate on things. I like to stew in my questions and my theories. I like to keep such things to myself until I'm really ready, right? One sunstreaked day this summer, when I was fairly certain, I told my girlfriend that I might change my mission. My girlfriend, who is an underpaid public school teacher, she listened very intently, asked some clarifying questions, as good teachers do. She then gently, firmly challenged me not to give up on what I believe in, even though it's hard, even if it feels impossible on most days. She reminded me of what I often tell people when I am seeking to be inspirational, to push us forward beyond our fear and our limitations. I say that the ancestors do not live in the past, they live in the future, and we are them. I say we may not live to see the fruits of our labor. We may not see the outcomes of the seeds that we have planted in our lifetimes. We should still build with grit and move through our personal and collective struggles with an unwavering belief in what is possible. Anecdote: I planted a red oak tree early in September 2020 with some friends who are in this room. During the height of the pandemic, and I admire this tree every day, I know that I will not live to see it 100 years from now when it is in its glory days. But the love that I pour into this tree will shade future generations with its magnificence. Perhaps my children's children will run around it someday, marvel at it spreading up towards the heavens. Maybe they'll collect its acorns, and if not them, somebody will. I place this faith in all the trees, shrubs, and rose bushes that I plant. We must speak in a way of dreams. We must act upon what we speak, even when our actions feel incomplete or in vain, even when we feel that we're set up to fail. For radical imagination is built on the faith of the unseen. So however flawed the messenger, myself, yourself, however doomed the mission may feel on any given day, my mission will stand: to unite the human spirit through the radical imagination. So what is the radical imagination? It lives in the music spun by our DJ this evening, Akasha Gabrieloff Parrish, AKA Atlantis Princess, AKA Big 4-4 Miss Full Moon. Let's make some noise for the DJ. As Basquiat proclaimed, visual art decorates space, but music decorates time. Radical imagination lives in this stream of images that I put together with some close artists. This stream of images that binds us to the natural world and to the cosmos. Radical imagination lives in the mind, body, heart, and spirit. It is necessary to look into the etymology of these words and ideas. Radical, meaning of or pertaining to the root. Literally, we are talking about the earth. We are talking about the core of our being, our essence, the spirit, the purpose of life, the root. Imagination. In Middle English, via Old French from Latin, the verb imaginare means to picture oneself. So how do you picture yourself? How do you see yourself in relation to the planet, our fellow people, our fellow companion species, the stars, the galaxies, the universe? So radical imagination is this superpower that connects us to the earth, the sky world, the center, and the four cardinal directions. It is the radical imagination that drives human innovation, placing our actions on a scale that dwarfs the impact of any other creature on the planet. Only the sun, the wind, the soil, the snow, and the rains have greater planetary impact than human beings. Let us think about radical imagination in relation to unity. Unity, originating from Latin, means oneness, sameness, or agreement. The Greek root henosis means mystical oneness or union. A unit is a single thing, a part of a whole. To add a Y to a word forms an adjective that suggests having the quality of, being analogous to something. So to use the word unity is to suggest that the individual units can be in deep relationship. Think of words like community, city, country, company, and so on. They all have a Y at the end of them. What are the origins of this radical imagination? I have read and heard from numerous sources in person and online, in books and so forth, that the radical imagination can be traced back to historical movements for racial, social, political, and economic justice. It can be traced back to the liberation struggle to end slavery. It can be traced back to the struggle to survive American colonialism and the Western expansion. It can be traced back to the women's suffrage movement and to all people who fought alongside those who have faced repression. The civil and human rights struggles of the 60s and 70s were fueled by radical imagination. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. often spoke of the importance of imagination, the public imagination, the moral imagination. In the words of Jewish American writer and poet Adrian Rich, writing during that transformative period, But nothing less than the most radical imagination will carry us beyond this place, beyond the mere struggle for survival, to that lucid recognition of our possibilities, which will keep us impatient and unresigned to mere survival. Radical imagination is the force that gave birth to hip-hop in the West and South Bronx of New York City in the early 70s. It gave birth to the Chicano movement and the Chicano arts movement here in the West during that same period. We could attribute the radical imagination to countless other art forms and movements across time and space in the United States and the world. Radical imagination is found in modern day visions to end mass incarceration, to transition to renewable resources, to house all human beings, to feed all human beings, to transform our economic and political systems and bend them towards social justice, human wellness, planetary wellness, and sustainability. Radical imagination reaches back deeper than this. It can be traced back to every continent, to the first languages, the first dances, the first stories, the first constellations, the first drums and instruments used to imitate the human heart and the rhythms and rhymes of the natural world. It can be traced back to the oceans and the first organisms. Radical imagination lives and grows in the mind of a child. Take yourself back to your 5-year-old self, your 6-year-old self, 7-year-old self. You were an artist and everything was possible. It is a revolutionary act to hold on to your imagination. It is a revolutionary act to assert and reclaim this imagination at any stage of life. So who owns the radical imagination? He, she, and they who choose to. There are three things that make human beings unique among all creatures on the planet. One is our capacity to destroy. Two is our capacity to create. Three is our futurist tendencies. There is no other creature on the planet that is constantly thinking about the next day, the next week, the next month, the next year, the next generation, the next 7 generations. This is power. There is a mass level of power and potential to impact the shared reality on this planet. And this goes for all of us, all of our relations. I have heard that the radical imagination is a POC thing, a people of color thing, that it is a black thing, an activist thing, an artist thing, that it is a technological thing or an intellectual thing, that it is something that women hold within their wombs, that it is GLBTQ+ and non-binary. This is all true. And beyond any and all of that, the radical imagination is a human thing because it is a force of nature, a universal force, Ometeo, the supreme essence of the creative forces that make all things possible. No one group of people can claim to own the radical imagination only for themselves. This is a shared gift that roots us back into our purpose on this planet and among the stars. Radical imagination lives within us all, but it must be activated. And activating it will cause friction and disruption. We're in a transformative time. And radical imagination is stifled and distorted by our judgmental and divisive tendencies. Racialized conflicts in our scenes, social movements, organizations, and institutions is not radical imagination. It doesn't matter who is instigating the conflict. Judgment of self and judgment of others is not radical imagination. Cancel culture is not radical imagination. Doubling down on division is not radical imagination. That is all status quo. I hope that you were inspired tonight. That is the comfort zone. And I hope that you feel uncomfortable at some point. That is the edge, and both are necessary for transformation. Know that conflict and confrontation will come with this work because that is part of the human experience. And out in the cosmos, as here on the planet, it is friction that gives birth to new realities. How we choose to deal with the conflict is also a matter of imagination. As you find yourself inspired tonight, I extend to you a warning, an invitation, and an affirmation by way of my late friend and mentor, Esteban Lucero. He always used to tell me, when you step into the ring as an artist, and remember that we are all artists, you're gonna get your ass kicked. But you should still be a fool and do it anyway, because that's love. Recognize that all activism and all artistry are acts of righteousness. self-righteousness, cultural righteousness, social righteousness, spiritual righteousness, and so on. So you will be challenged. So if you're going to step into the arena, expect the challenge. Expect to make some waves, to stir up the pot, and thus to make some enemies, or maybe some frenemies. You will probably find yourself at odds with people who you think should be on your team. It is what it is. Seeking to change yourself and thus the world does not come without pain and sacrifice. But in memory of Audre Lorde, we were never meant to survive. So keep pushing, keep dreaming, keep building and rebuilding when things fall apart. Fear and pessimism are the tools of the oppressors. Optimism is the tool of the creators. Radical imagination is the belief that anything and everything is possible because the future is unwritten. It is undetermined. It is up to us what we are doing now. We don't vote every 2 years, every 4 years. We vote every day. We make 35,000 mostly unconscious choices every day. And with each of that choice, there is a vote, there is an act, there is a possibility. Radical imagination is the belief that what you have poured your heart into matters even when you fail. Radical imagination is what you are doing even and especially when nobody is looking. There's no way out of the countless crises that we are facing. The only way out is through. And with 8 billion people on the planet dependent upon the air, the soil, the water, the sun, and the moon, there is no way through if we do not find new pathways to interdependence. We can exit fear and division. We cannot exit our shared responsibilities to the planet and to each other. The most compelling paths forward are to reimagine how the units fit together. The unity. To recombine, reconfigure, and rebuild the fractured whole, however small our victories may be. Every contribution is valuable. We must give more of our time to celebrating our wins, and we should probably have more fun along the way. Thank you.
Amazing, thank you. That was beautiful. Thank you, Molina Speaks. Now is the part of the program where we're going to invite both of our speakers back to the stage and encourage questions on both topics at the same time, if you can. So I'll invite Molina and Viniyanka back to join me. And tonight we have a very special prize for the person who makes the best connection. And trust me, you're going to want to win it. So please, as you enter your questions in tonight, add your name so we can call you to the stage at the end. This is the QR code. You can scan that and begin entering your questions. And hopefully, Molina and Viniyanka will join me, and we'll get started. All right. Yes. Welcome back. You give them a round of applause. Wonderful talks tonight. And here you are. You'll need that. I'm gonna start, Molina, asking if you can describe the flower mandala that we are sitting in and the intention that you had behind this. We all saw you building this as we sat down tonight. So tell us a little bit about where we're at within this mandala.
This is an offering to the radical imagination. And when we are done here this evening, I invite you to come and take a flower and to take it back to your home or your community and to make an offering to a place that you would like to activate the radical imagination.
And that's lovely. Thank you. All right. And we'll begin with the questions from the audience. The first one tonight is from Megan, and Megan asks, oh, never mind. The first one tonight is from Siri, but not spelled that way. How can we use radical imagination to envision a world with the penal system abolished? What does that world look like? And we're going to gong that question. And anytime you make a crossover question tonight, we're going to gong it, because it's nice. So. All right. Would you like to tackle that first, Viniyanka?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's the core of the thing, is like that question of there's this idea that we are using a logical system. We're using really the only logical system that's been presented. And is that really true is the question. And that's, so if it isn't true, then where do we go from there? And that takes us to...
It's gonna take time, you know? Like, we want it to happen right away. And it has taken generations to build up this crisis of over-incarceration. It's gonna take generations to undo it. And, you know, it's all the things we know, right? It's like the marches, the policy work, the activism, and it's also changing ourselves and the way that we interact with each other. You know, like we cannot expect society to change its policies on judgment if we are constantly in self-judgment, if we are constantly in judgment of others. So how do we deal with conflict in familia? You know, how do we deal with conflict in community? How do we deal with conflict at work? You know, how do we come together and try to solve things without so much judgment? It starts every single day. And you know, there's like, we need space. And prisons are the most attractive spaces. But all of these massive buildings and their infrastructure can be transformed into a lot of things that serve the human good, the common good, and the planetary good. So we need to imagine what those things are and begin building models and blueprints so that when a prison is shut down, when policies change, we're ready to step in and, you know, transform that into something that we want to see.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. The next question tonight comes from Sarah the Great. You're invited to my Sarah's Only party, by the way. From whom's radical imagination did the current penal system come from? I think that one's for you, Viniyanka.
I think we addressed that.
I'm going to gong it. It's a crossover. There we go.
I think we got into that a little bit. And I mean, that's the conversation that has been so hard to move forward. And to be honest with you, I'm not sure that I really thought that even in my lifetime that conversation would really move forward. And I think that's an important part of going back to that idea of, like, how do you get to this place of radical imagination? It's also rethinking what we're doing in these conversations, what we're doing when we're talking about the change that's happening now. We have to understand that solution doesn't mean that we see the end result ourselves in this lifetime. It means that we're adding to that pot that means change. And over time, that change has an effect. And we have to not give into that idea that just because we don't see the end result of it, it's not worth doing, right? So I think for me, I actually had a moment in 2020 when I saw the Minnesota City Council start to defund its police system. And I had really given in to the idea that in my lifetime, I would never see real change. And that moment, I thought, wow, that is change. I got to see it. It's really possible. And it changed me.
If I can add something, you know, I would say that, like, in addition to the corporations that are seeking profit, you know, and white supremacy and, you know, the colonial legacy and all of these different things that we often point to, like, we have to acknowledge that this is something that lives within all of us, you know, this desire to control, this desire to take more than what we need, you know, and so, you know, white supremacy, colonialism, the prison industrial complex, you know, slavery, so on and so forth, like, these things go back in human history on every continent, like, beyond the United States. And again, there is something that needs healed and changed and shifted within all of us. And really, like, I think that's what we're here to do, like, right now in this time.
Yeah, that's lovely. It's planting that tree that your children and your children's children will play underneath. The next question tonight comes from Franklin. And Franklin asks, what does nature's radical imagination, I apologize for that, have to teach us about redirecting behavior that we call criminal.
That's such a Franklin.
You're waiting for the gong, I know, and I... There we go. Gonged it. Thank you, Franklin.
Just thank you, Franklin, for being yourself with that question. I appreciate it. But I think, you know, I mean, to me, again, it's that idea of foundational story is also nature. Where did it all start, and what made something look a certain way inside of a person themselves, and what makes us perceive it a certain way? And are there pieces of how we are interacting with the world around us that's influencing all of those things that we need to be rethinking every single day? Not just the way in which we shape one another, because that is how, that's how every single day, every single interaction shapes the person next to you, but the bigger picture of how we are being shaped by everything that's around us as well. I think allowing the reality that that change is constant and that change doesn't ever stop is a big piece of what changes our penal system, because the truth is we don't have that built in to our understanding of criminality right now. We don't really have this idea that your worst moment shouldn't be defining of who you are. And, you know, if we rethink that very core and we allow ourselves to understand that movement is constant, we allow ourselves to believe in that, then maybe we can allow ourselves to believe in something other than incarceration.
I would say two things. One is nature is messy. You know, like if you get out and like go for a hike, like up in nature, it's like there's, you know, a lot going on. Like it doesn't look like this. You know, like it's messy. The human process is messy, and it's not all namaste and peaceful. You know, like I just got stung by ground nesting yellow jackets when I was mowing the lawn the other day. I was like, this is a, you know, this is like the Hunger Games where they introduce a new element out of nowhere. You know, like the HOA or the city of Denver is like, Molina hasn't been mowing his lawn. You know, we got to introduce the ground nesting hornets. You know, like there's like violence and destruction, and things aren't always peaceful, you know? And so I think we need to remember that the human project is, it's a project, you know, like trying to figure out the best way to be people together. The famed historian and social critic Noam Chomsky, I've always heard him talk about how violent and brutal human history has actually been. You know, and we romanticize certain peoples and certain continents as like just being the ideal, but like it's been a pretty brutal history at different times on every continent, and so it is quite the project for human beings to figure out how to be in balance with each other and the natural world.
Oh, that's such a nice place to segue into our next question from B. And B asks, it's a two-part question. I'm going to skip to the second part to build on what you just said, which is, should we imprison some people's imagination?
I'm going to pass that one to the left.
All right, I got to take the hard one first, huh?
I'll take it with you, but you know, yeah. I've been talking a lot, so you go ahead.
You know, I mean, I think that is, I mean, you know, I show up with trust, honestly, and I think that's one of the scariest things that we can do is to show up with trust for one another and see where that leads us and see each other,
yes, naps.
You know, yeah, I mean, see what we're each capable of and like allow each other to show what that is. If we assume what that is, then we shape what that is, in my opinion. So I think we gotta let people be people, and we have to be honest about the fact that humans are messy and the fact that each one of us is really, really messy. So maybe if we all agree that that's true, then we can start to help each other, you know, find what collective good really does look like.
Here we go.
The police system, you know, it grows out of the overseer system, right? And the plantations and the institution of slavery. Um, I'm not going to say that there shouldn't be any police or any prisons. Maybe it should look a lot different than it does, but I don't know what to do with those elements of the radical imagination that lead people to abuse and to do horrible things to other people. You know, that's a real problem that we have to face and we have to be real about. And I think it's a balance, you know, and we're clearly out of balance. Like, we need far less prisons if we're gonna have prisons at all. And what can we imagine beyond prisons, you know, when it comes to working to rehabilitate people, but for people who will not be rehabilitated, for people who want to enslave and hurt and abuse other people, like, what do we do with those elements of the imagination? I don't have a good answer for that, but I know that the over-incarceration problem that we have is probably the first thing we need to address if we are going to change our collective approach to dealing with unwanted behavior.
I gotta say, you know, that question, I think that's the question that we get stuck on is, yeah, bad things happen in the world and what do we do about them? But the truth is, the real understanding of abolition comes from the idea that you gotta go beyond that. You gotta ask the question of what would this world look like if we actually took care of one another in the first place? And then maybe all those bad things are not things we would have to be addressing.
Absolutely.
Yep. Lovely. All right, Mel asks, on a slightly different note, are eyewitness testimony in radical imagination two sides of the same coin?
Can you repeat that?
Are eyewitness testimony and radical imagination two sides of the same coin? Oh, and Mel goes further to ask, are brains trying to make sense of things that we want to believe are true?
I just have to say, whoever asked this question, I'm going to bring you in front of a jury, because I think that's a fair question to, I mean, we really need to think about what it is that our brain is capable of. I truly believe that one of the things that holds us back is that, you know, we do all this work about understanding our bodies, right? Like, you go to school and you take biology class. You learn a lot about the natural world, but what's the thing that we never really talk about? Our minds. Why are we never talking about this? Our mind is the most complex organ in our body, and yet it's just like literally nothing that we ever think, oh, you know, I mean, from grade school, kids should probably know about that so that we understand ourselves better. But our mind is a space of infinite possibility, and understanding that that's true and not assuming that what comes from your mind is going to be reflective of reality is an important starting point for all of us. So I would love to present to a jury the defense of radical imagination memory.
Any thoughts? Nope, you're good. All right. We're going to move on to the next question. This one's coming from Anonymous. What is a singular aspect of the penal system that, if changed, would have the greatest change towards what we radically imagine? And I missed gonging the last question, so I'm gonna gong this one twice. There we go.
You have something off the top.
Yeah, I think you're getting suggestions from the audience. Shout outs.
Shout those out again.
In cash bail. No.
That is an easy one we can agree on, I think. I think I already did answer it, actually. I think it was my last answer that I gave. I don't know that we know what it looks like when we treat each other, you know, from a place of trust, from a place of wanting each other to be safe, from a place of allowing each other to be the messy human beings that we are. I think if we could move towards that place, if we really got into that space where it didn't scare us so much, each one of us, the idea that we don't have full control over ourselves, and so probably the person next to us doesn't either, if we could have that baseline understanding, I think that would change the root of how we approach things.
I have two concrete ideas. One would be ending all private prison contracts and just outlawing private prisons. That would be a good start. I also think that a policy of no incarceration for people who commit nonviolent acts, I think would be huge, because the majority of people who are in our prisons are in prison for nonviolent offenses, and many of them for drug offenses, small drug offenses. So, you know, I think that there's a lot of pathways to work with people beyond prison when people have not committed a violent offense against another human being.
Very nice. All right, this one's moving from the big system to our own internal systems, and Tim Hernandez asks, in what ways do we create our own personal penal systems that limit and prevent the radical imagination of ourselves?
I mean, I'll take it back to judgment, you know, like self-judgment and judgment of other people's. We are constantly in a situation, the majority of us, and it comes from the messaging we get from media, from commercials, it comes from capitalism, but we are constantly in a place of judgment of self and judgment of other people, and it gets in the way of all pathways of creativity. And you can work on it from either perspective. You know, you can really try to create new pathways in your mind for your own self-judgment, your own self-doubt, your own self-negativity. And if you work on that, you will find that you are less judgmental of other people. Or if you find yourself constantly, like, belittling and berating and mocking and, you know, clowning other people in your own mind, like, start to shift that, and you will find yourself less judgmental of yourself. But I think that judgment feeds into the constant division on all levels, interpersonally, and when we get into the realms of, you know, race, religion, gender, you know, sexuality, so on and so forth. You know, it's just like judgment on loop 24/7 that is fed to us through the TV screen and now our phones, first and foremost.
Yeah, absolutely. That self-judgment and fear, that's, I think, tied in together. And also, you know, it was a line that you said, the idea that we get relegated to this space of just survival, and we don't move outside of that, and we don't ask for more than that. And so maybe that's a big piece of it, how that ends up happening, that we get into this routine of, you know, we set certain standards of what our life is supposed to look like, and then we keep trying to just meet those basic things that we think those are our basic needs, and we're not necessarily looking at that bigger picture, that bigger world around us, and being, you know, creative about what it is that we even want to be seeking for ourselves.
That's lovely. I think we have time for one more quick question tonight. We're going to take this one from Trisha. She asks, if AI helps us solve the issue of aging and death, how do you imagine we would change our guidelines to within the new paradigm of immortal life?
AI will not help us with aging and death.
Come on, we're radically imagining things here.
Agreed.
HI will. AI will not.
All right.
But change is, you know, inevitable. And so I think we can, we got to embrace the world around us. The nature, the things that we put into the world, the things that we put into each other.
This is a testament here to impermanence. We are here for a short time, not a long time. And yet this life is very long and fruitful if you approach it from a place of possibility and imagination. And so take one of these flowers and plant it in a place where you want to see imagination grow.
Oh, that's a beautiful note to end it on. Thank you so much. Thank you, Molina. Thank you, Viniyanka. Thank you, audience, for your wonderful questions. All right, each week we give a prize. Oh, it's prize time. Each week we forget that there's a prize time video. Each week We give a prize to the person who makes the best connection, as chosen by MCA's digital producer, Dele Johnson. Tonight, he has chosen his favorite question, and the person who submitted it will receive this beautiful print, which we have here so that you can all see it. This is from MCA's shop. I think we exceeded the budget that we gave the shop folks for prizes, but that our loss is your gain. So this is a beautiful print. It's by Suzanne Coons, and we hope that you enjoy it in your home. We hope that red and black are your color scheme. And we have here the tonight's winner question. And the award goes to, and the print goes to, the print goes to Tim Hernandez, who asks, in what ways, yes, please applaud Tim. Tim asks, in what ways do we create our own personal penal systems that limit and prevent the radical imagination of ourselves and others? Thank you, Tim. Are you here? You are. Look, is Glenn still here? We should take a picture of Tim with this print that matches Tim's clothes. That's lovely. Congratulations. Yes, of course. And we have a roll thing, if you prefer to roll that up later to transport. Okay, good. All right, now the moment that you've all been waiting for. We're going to invite Brenton back to the stage to enlighten us with original poem by tonight's talks. I think we have a video for that too. A poetic ending, yes, that's right. So please, give it up again for Brenton Zola.
Hello.
There we go.
Hello. Could I have the screen off, Daley? Or anyone else who's back there? You know what this is? This is a void. Silence is a void. Void comes from the Latin root vacare, which means to abandon, to vacate. Imagination starts in a void. It's the place where it's birthed out of empty space. But a void is also a place where you abandon something. So when we incarcerate people, we throw them into the void. And so as you think about what you're leaving with today, I want everyone to speak out, maybe a word, a short sentence, as you think about your imagination, as we fill the void together, what would you like to speak into the void? And this is an actual question. Yes. A little louder. Thank you. Between the breath and the voice, there is a void. beautiful streets, beautiful nation. I ask myself, can I radical imagination? Can I go inside my brain, inside my mind? When I line the streets, we are never resigned, because they forget your face, they switch up your name. When you look at sun through the glass, that's the window's pane. Because when they don't know your identity in your soul, when we step in back here, because we know we're on a roll, we have to build our buildings, we have to build our cities, we have to get down into the mind, to the nitty gritty, into the hippocampus, into the insula. Because right now, I'm telling you right now, it is from me to you, it is unity. I'm asking why, because unity to you to me, we start with why. Because that is of the act of the nation, that is the place where we have radical imagination, but we incarcerate, we feel ourselves with hate. And we ask ourselves, are we irate? Are we bringing anger into the streets? Are we bringing guns, bringing heat? Do we need release? I'm feeling here in the heart. I'm telling stories here from the very start. Because right now, I'm asking, we are all in this. Imagination, incarceration starts with eyewitness. Because I witness you in the heart, in the soul. I witness justice here. We are right on a roll. I wish alignment. I wish justice. I wish love from the skies above. Because Molina taught me to stir some pots, to bring the heat, some wasps, and make it hot. He taught me to go out of the cage, because right now sometimes you have to speak your rage, just like your Audre Lorde, because I'm hanging from my bell hooks. I'm here in the chessboard, I'm moving rooks and kings. I'm right in the wing, because right here in imagination, that's where the soul sings. It's been mixed taste, we've been mixing ideas from you to me, because you know it's the sightseer, the sight here, right here in the mind. Open up your mind, you see the gears grind. Break open your imagination, break open your brain, because right now we're gonna make a new lane, we're gonna make a new world, the mystery is unfurled. I ask yourself, what kind of world would you build? What do you want to defend? Because the future is not at the end. The future is now. In a place where we don't bow or kowtow, in a place where we find connection between streets, between blood veins, between people, between souls, between minds, between hearts. Where we find our stories from different bloodlines, different origins, and we ask ourselves, can we mix our taste? Can we mix our ideas to form one melting pot of unity? Because unity is community, it's you and me. So what can you imagine? What will you build? So step back and simply believe, because I have to just stir some pots, then I'm gonna leave. So right now, I'm saying we're at the end. We are turning the page, and who knows what's at the end. We turn until the last cover to cover, because right now I'm singing from here to my mother, to my ancestors who are right here in my spirit. Hear my voice through my voice. I'm saying, do you hear it? It's the last time, there won't be a next time. I look for the beauty, I look for the sublime. So I'm saying right now, I'm giving you a reason. Everyone in Mixed Taste, we'll see you next season.
Thank you, Brenton.
Yes. Right.
On the count of three, everybody say, God bless the poets. 1, 2, 3.
God bless the poets.
Yeah.
That's right, that's right. Thank you, Viniyanka. Thank you, Molina. Thank you, Chanel. And thank you, audience, for this wonderful mixed taste season. We'll see you next year.
Unexpected. Mm. tri-dimensional. I'm a lazy